Beloved brothers and sisters, good morning and welcome, as I like to say, to the Greek Orthodox Church of St. Demetrios in Elmhurst, Illinois. We are glad you could join us today. We are very honored and blessed to have you with us, and we thank you for your love and for your support as we forge ahead in celebrating the feast of our patron saint, St. Demetrios. Every year we celebrate Ta Dimitria, celebrations that focus around our faith, our church, and of course our patron saint. And this year we've invited a truly blessed, spirit-filled theologian and priest of the Greek Orthodox Archdiocese of America. Father Evan Armatas is the priest of St. Spirit on Church in Loveland, Colorado. He founded and manages the St. Nectarios Education Fund, a nonprofit student education program. Father Evan is the host of the popular podcast Transforming Our Lives in Christ and the live call-in radio show Orthodoxy Live on Ancient Faith Radio. You can visit his talks and lectures and teachings at ancientfaith.com to listen to his many podcasts. Please give a warm welcome to our beloved Father Evan Armatas, who is with us today as we continue to celebrate our patron saint, Ta Dimitria, on this day. We'd also like to welcome as well his presbytera, Stacy Anastasia. There she is. If you just stand up so everyone sees you real quick. Presbytera, welcome. All the way, yes, give it up. All the way from Colorado, we welcome you and, of course, Father Evan to our home here at St. Demetrios.
Go get him. Good morning. Christ is in our midst. I think it's popular to say around here, go Cubs. Is that right? I'm a Cubby fan, and I woke up this morning and I was thinking, what should I wear that shows that I'm a Cubby fan? And of course, you're limited in what you can wear. I think the only thing that really bothered my wife when I got ordained was the fact that I was going to be stuck wearing those funny black shirts. And I said, well, there's not really a choice here. I could go with funny black shirt or funny black robe, but I don't really have a choice to wear a Cubby, so I wore a blue t-shirt underneath. My wife and I came in a little bit early. We've enjoyed being in Chicago. It's a city that I have family from, but I hadn't been to Chicago in over 20 years. And when Father Andrew called me last spring and invited me to come, I immediately said yes, because he's a classmate and I wanted to support him, but B, I wanted to come. I wanted to see Chicago. I wanted to get a sense of the city again in my adult years. Like I said, I'd been here since I was a kid. And also to connect with the faithful here in Chicago. And so it's a joy to be here. And already I've seen some people that I've known for years, and some of you have come up to me. I've connected with a couple of people that I have never seen before but heard in name only. And the way that God works, he's constantly connecting us. I had someone come up to me and said, oh, we're Perry Homolis's. He's now Deacon Perry, Homolis's godparents. And I went to college with Perry Homolis, Deacon Perry, and I hadn't seen Perry in, gosh, I haven't seen him in 15 years. He was in Seoul, Korea. And there's a listener in Seoul from Orthodoxy Live's show that writes to me. And so I had parishioners going to Seoul, and I said, hey, when you're in Seoul, you should look up this listener. And so they did. And he took them on a tour of Seoul, and he took them to the Orthodox Church there in the capital. And Perry, Deacon Perry, was there on a Fulbright scholarship. So they took a picture on the steps of the church. They texted me the picture. I look at this picture. It had been 15 years since I had seen Deacon Perry. And I look at the picture and think, gosh, that sure looks a lot like Perry Homolis. And it was Perry. Didn't know it at the time. And then today I show up here, and where's his godparents? I met them I mean, his godparents. I think, you know, God's always connecting us. And if you're Orthodox, your family's pretty small. You can kind of make your way from one part of the country to another. I see another dear friend who stopped at my parish in St. Spirit on this summer, whose father was the founder of this parish. And so, Father Andrew, thanks for inviting me to be here. Father Andrew and I were schoolmates. Now, he didn't remember this, but Father Andrew and I took part in a really famous event. There's an annual football game at Holy Cross where the seminary takes on the college. It's important. And when I arrived at the seminary, the college had been taking the seminary to task every year. We'd been several years. We co-quarterbacked, and we steamrolled the college. I mean, look at that guy. Look at me. I mean, Father Andrew, thank you. It's an absolute pleasure to be here at St. Demetrios on your patronal feast and as part of your celebration. I was married in the parish of St. Demetrios in Seattle, Washington, and it was very formative for me, and I love this saint, St. Demetrios. Been to his church in Thessaloniki. Has anybody been to that wonderful? Oh my goodness. If you haven't been, obviously you need to go. It's a beautiful, beautiful church, and you have an incredible saint, a wonderful saint, the Myrrh Gusher. And we ask and hope that St. Demetrios will be with us and intercede for us this day. I want you to imagine the following. It's around 3 p.m. in the afternoon, and a man rises in order to go and pray. Like his ancestors before him, going back generations that cannot be numbered, he follows a set and regular schedule of prayer. He knows these times of prayer as the first, third, and ninth hour. For us, that's 6 a.m., 9 a.m., and 3 p.m. And since his youth, he has followed this daily rhythm. It's how he connects with God each day through prayer. Now, on this particular day, it's the ninth hour. And he makes his way to the temple to pray, but he's not alone. With him at this hour of prayer is a companion, and together they make their way onto the temple grounds in Jerusalem. And we should imagine that the temple grounds is not just like this parish of St. Demetrios, but rather it's a large complex. There's several entrances and porticos. As they walk in, they encounter a man. And this man is born without the ability to walk. It's this man that is healed by the power of Jesus Christ. And so let's pick up the story as it appears in Acts chapter 3, verses 6 through 8. And I know you have pew Bibles if you want to use them, or if you have the Orthodox Study Bible on your phone, you can draw this up, but I'll read it to you. Then Peter said, "Silver and gold I do not have, but what I do have I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up, and immediately his feet and his ankle bones received strength. So he, leaping up, stood and walked and entered the temple with them, walking, leaping, I love that, and praising God. As I open our retreat this morning, and Father Andrew should be credited with its title, Uncompromising Faith in Compromising Times, I wanted to offer to your consideration a timeless scene from Holy Scripture that I believe provides a bit of context for our time together. My reasoning is simple. As I think of this title, Uncompromising Faith, I'm reminded that this word uncompromising has synonyms like unyielding, resolute, firm, and unshakable. And those words easily describe our faith. They easily describe our church. We like these words. We use them when we speak to others about what we believe. And you wouldn't have to go far to find an Orthodox Christian who wasn't proud of the fact that the traditions of the church have not changed. We say that our faith is without addition or subtraction. It's this idea of fullness without change that runs counter to the other part of our title, faith in compromising times. Now, if you take a look around you, in the news, in life, school, at work, all we see is compromise. And we, as a result, have learned to, maybe imperceptibly, set aside what we hold dear in order to get along. It's better to be quiet as a Christian today. And we have reached with society, if you will, a mutually agreed upon agreement. We won't speak the truth in the public sphere. I think we lack a certain measure of vigilance today, and thus we have been open to altering our faith without careful examination. So as we begin this first gathering this morning, we do so with this title, Uncompromising Faith in Compromising Times, and a subtitle, Elements of Faith That Matter. My goal this morning, then, is to set up this juxtaposition between uncompromising and compromising of that which passes versus that which is eternal and remains steadfast. And so, I hope, as you heard that opening story, you might ask yourself this question. What is timeless? It's an obscure passage of Scripture to pick out. What is timeless, what's firm, what's unshakable about the passage I just read? If you think about it, there are a lot of things about the passage that have been compromised. Is the temple gone? Yes. There's no more temple in Jerusalem. How about the gates where this lame man begged? Are they there? No. Is St. Peter alive? How about his companion St. John, who was with him on that day? No. Or the man they healed? He's dead too. All of them have passed away. And so what is left, if anything, of this story? What's remained uncompromised in it? Now, if you take a moment and you carefully consider the story, you can begin to tease out elements from the story that provide an alternative view of things, something uncompromised. But I'm going to lift out only one. You ready for it? The hour of prayer. The text tells us that Peter, along with John, went up at the ninth hour to pray. How many of you have been to the royal hours? Do we still have a ninth hour? We do. This set hour of prayer, as we mentioned in our opening, was something for Jews that went back centuries, millennia. It was something they always kept if they were pious. And Peter, a follower and disciple of Jesus, was a pious Jew. Even after his crucifixion, even after his Lord and Savior's death on the cross, Peter kept the hours of prayer. It was not something he would have abandoned easily. He wouldn't have even considered it. He wouldn't have changed with the times. Now, a lot has happened since that day. I counted it up. Since the temple has been destroyed, it's almost 700,000 days. And the people who destroyed it, do you know who did? Do you remember who? The Romans. Is the Roman Empire gone? It's past. And most people, if you ask a Christian if they've heard of the hour of prayer, most would say no. In fact, many Orthodox Christians don't even remember that we have these things called the hour of prayer. Yet, as I said to you, the church remembers. Some have not forgotten or changed this practice of prayer. And if you go to a monastery, you'll still enter into the hours of prayer. In some of our churches, they still keep the hours. If you have the app that comes from the archdiocese, it will still populate your phone with the prayer of the hour of the day. Did you know that? We still have the first, the third, the sixth, and even the ninth hours. You can even buy a prayer book that has the daily hours of prayer. The church has not compromised its position on prayer. Now let me shift our focus. Let's move forward from that scene in Acts 2,000 years to 2005. Most of us have heard of the interview the presidential nominee Donald Trump gave about women. In the interview, the Republican candidate for president of the United States is recorded. Now don't worry, this is not going to be a political talk. But he was recorded making offensive and lewd comments about women and how he treats them. And the comments that he made led to an avalanche of commentary. And in our compromising times, some dismissed the comments, the candidate included. It's nothing more than locker room talk, as if talking like this in a locker room is acceptable. Some tried to shift the focus from the candidate's comments to other things, like the opposing candidate. After all, hasn't she shown morally reprehensible behavior as well? So, I did wrong, but she's done wrong. As if two wrongs made a right. Some, very few, but some, have defended Trump's comments. While many, whether it's from the NFL, to Hollywood, to Lifetime politicos, denounced his comments as unacceptable. Now, within the commentary, there's a point to what I'm talking about. As I said, I'm not here to talk politics. Rather, I'm a priest, and politics is not my calling. But I do think that as a priest, one of the offices that Father Andrew and I share is the office of the prophet. I'm here to act like a canary in the coal mine. I'm here to tell you that the air in the room in which we sit is no longer good. It's compromised. And so I'm contrasting these two narratives, that of Peter and John in the temple, that of Trump being interviewed, in order to get you to think about our theme, uncompromising faith in compromising times. On the one hand, we have a story of two men going up to the temple at the hour of prayer. On the other hand, we have the comments of a man about women and the fallout and debate that has surrounded it. And I can say with absolute certainty that in 100 years, no one will be talking about Trump. But everyone will still talk and know about Peter and John. Where do we place our emphasis? Now, the story about Trump, I do think, can serve our purpose today, an internal purpose. And here's how. All right. In 2011, the author E.L. James released his first novel in what is now a trilogy of books. The books are mainstream, and they are unabashedly erotic and sadistic. When I was growing up, I'm only 47, but in my day, while I was growing up, the books that E.L. James wrote would have been rated X-rated. The title of his first book is called 50 Shades of Grey. Has anybody heard of this book? It was a blockbuster movie. I had parishioners telling me, "Father, you should read this book." Now, he went on, Mr. James, to write two more. And as I said, these books would have been sold behind the counter when I was growing up, but now they are mainstream. In fact, the series is one of the best-selling series of all time. It's sad to note that a country that produced such authors as Great Britain has can no longer say that any of them have outsold E.L. James. In fact, his book, 50 Shades of Grey, set the record in Great Britain for the fastest and best-selling paperback of all time. This is a country that has an abbey, a monastery across from Parliament, Westminster Abbey. Visit it. I have. Barely a handful of people there for evening prayer. Now, in America, 1 out of 10 adults have read the books. 1 out of 10. And if you're a woman, the percentage goes up. 2 out of 10. And so that got me wondering, okay, if 2 out of 10 American women have read this book, and yet millions of American women have protested against what Trump said, because the books portray women being subjugated to physical domination. It's rather sick, what's in the book. Now, it gets worse, because the percentage of Christians who've read the book compared to the percentage of Christians who haven't read the book, it's the same. Christians are reading these books, just as many Christians are reading these books as non-Christians. And the point is, we have a decreasing desire, if even an absent desire, to maintain virtuous in our private lives, but an uncanny ability to still ask others to be virtuous, like a presidential candidate. We are willing to compromise, but we still have the notion that someone shouldn't. You following my point? Shouldn't that be reversed? What does the Lord say? First, remove the log from your own eye. Then you will see clearly to remove the speck from your brother's. Our topic is uncompromising faith in compromising times, and the news isn't good. Compromising times, that seems to be the phrase. That seems to be the theme of our lives. And we have to think carefully about this. Now, recently, a well-known clergyman in our archdiocese, that's the Greek archdiocese, refused to commune a person who was openly living with another person outside the sacrament of marriage. Does that seem like he should do that? Well, the priest was roundly criticized in his parish for what was characterized by his parishioners as ignorant, mean-spirited, and judgmental. His parishioners told him what he did was wrong. So the question becomes, if in the church we become compromised, how are we ever going to flip the switch again? How are we going to get back to uncompromised faith in the church? Now, I've mentioned, obviously, the mainstreaming of sexual deviancy, but of course, the symptoms of our society are much worse. And trust me, I'm not a doom and gloom guy. But when I was given this title, I had to think about, well, what's so compromising about our times? Well, you do a little research, the symptoms are terrible. In my home state of Colorado, you can guess what the number one reason tourists visit now. It's not skiing. Why do people come to Colorado? To smoke dope. They call it marijuana tourism. And guess what? The legalization of marijuana is soon coming to your state too. Just wait for it. It'll come here. It's going to be on the ballot in plenty of states. And for most of us, I'm a priest. For me to question the use of marijuana is, for many people, an unacceptable position. It's silly. People say to me all the time now, Father, why hasn't the church gotten over its old-fashioned position? Why are you opposing the use of marijuana? It's legal. So is abortion. But that doesn't make it okay, right? Legal's not okay, right? These are compromising times. Can you gamble everywhere? Yeah, you can. Where can you not gamble in the United States? You used to have to fly somewhere. Vegas. What stays in Vegas or what happens in Vegas? No, what happens in Vegas didn't stay in Vegas. That slogan didn't work. What happens in Vegas goes everywhere. Gambling's legal. Is it legal to euthanize someone? It is in some states. It's on the ballot in Colorado. How about the concept of marriage? Well, the state petition that I get when someone goes to get their license no longer says male, female. It says candidate one and candidate two. Now, I wonder what that means. In other words, could I just pick anything to be my spouse? And 40 million Americans a day visit a pornographic website. That's a third of those visits are women. And how about opioids? In 2012, we prescribed enough opioids for every American to have their own bottle. Since 1999, painkiller prescriptions have quadrupled. And the number one cause, we did it, folks, the number one cause of accidental death in the U.S. is now prescription overdose. And as I said, it's not any different in the church now. Who can honestly say that if a priest stands up or if a bishop stands up and openly opposes what is routinely accepted now in society, he wouldn't be denounced? In a sermon not too long ago, I know a priest who had the audacity to challenge the annual church trip to a casino. Church sponsored, in the bulletin. Sign up today. He said to his parish, we can no longer sponsor the casino trip. He almost lost his position in the parish. I know another priest who said to his festival committee, you can no longer serve ouzo shots to the dance group because the dance group contains minors. Outrage. Another parish just went and said, well, let's just put a big banner up that says ouzo shots right in front of their church sign. And as I like to joke with my brother clergy, no one even has the courtesy to lie to me anymore about living together. Right? They come in to fill out their marriage affidavit and they just both put the address down, same address. I said, you know, 10 years ago they would at least lie to me. Something happened to us in Chicago. We stayed a couple days in Chicago. We went to watch the Cubs game. The person sitting next to us was drunk. Foul mouth. So she asked me, what do you do? I said, I'm a priest. You gotta be kidding me. It doesn't matter, right? That's what we live in. But it's time for us to search out the good again, to preach the light, to find it, to hold on to it, because we can't overcome evil with evil. And it's the light that overcomes the darkness. How can we recapture this good? How can we find the light again? So I'm not going to talk about any of the compromising stuff really anymore. I'm going to turn towards the light now, and I hope you'll turn towards it with me. To help you out, I'm going to give you a scenario. You know, I constantly get interested in these odd little ideas and facts, and one of them was navigation. How did people figure out how to navigate? So my wife and I were walking around Chicago the other day, and you know, you pull your phone out, right? And there's the little blue dot that tells you where you are. She says, "How does this work?" I said, "Well, I can tell you." In fact, the first way that people figured out how to navigate was with a stick. They take a stick and they'd hold it out at arm's length, and they'd put the bottom of the stick on the horizon, and they'd find a fixed point in the sky, and they'd put the top part of the stick, and as long as they held that stick and the top part, that which was fixed in the sky and the horizon, were on the top and the bottom of the stick, they were moving in the same direction. What did they create? Horizon, themselves, point in the sky. What is that? Triangle. How does GPS work? It triangulates your position. 24 satellites flipping around the Earth. You got your phone in your hand. Two of the satellites figure out you, two fixed points, triangle, they can tell you where you are. Now, how exact is GPS? Pretty exact, right? A few feet. Stick? About 60 miles, give or take. But not bad for a stick. Now, of course, when you're walking around with your phone, you never feel like you can get lost. But before that, you know, what people had to do is they had to look up into the sky. They literally looked up to find their way. I think that's providential. Whether you were on the sea or on land, if you wanted to get somewhere and not get lost, you looked into the heavens to find your way. They had to find one fixed point in the sky. If you lived in the northern hemisphere, that fixed point was, or is, the North Star. Polaris. It's the brightest star in Ursa Minor, the Little Bear. And with that insight, with that one fixed point, you wouldn't get lost. And for our retreat this morning, that is the suggestion I'm going to make. In order to have uncompromising faith in compromising time, you have to find one fixed point. And without a fixed point, everything becomes compromised. So, pull back. How does the biblical narrative support what I'm suggesting? Well, where does the journey of faith begin? Who starts it? Think, Old Testament, father of faith, Abraham. That's the father of faith, isn't it? Genesis chapter 12, verse 1. The first book of the Bible, Genesis, and here's how the 12th chapter opens. Now the Lord said to Abram. Now remember his name, Abram, it'll later be changed to Abraham. Starts as Abram. And so the Lord says to Abram, "Get out of your country, from your kindred, from your father's house, to a land I will show you." Think about this. It's a crazy request, isn't it? What if God showed up in a voice to you and said, "All right, here's the deal. I want you to pack up and leave. I want you to leave your family, I want you to leave your home, leave everything behind, and go to a land I'll show you." It's a crazy thing. And in the verse, God's introducing the idea of uncompromising faith by putting Abraham on a journey. Now we should ask, how is God going to keep Abraham on course? What's he going to do? How is he going to keep him from getting lost? So let's unpack the verse to find out. Now, does the verse say that Abram can take anything with him? No. Does he get a map? No. Does he get a compass? They weren't invented. So he can't take a compass. Directions? Nothing. He's asked to leave behind everything that is familiar to him. His country, his belongings, but I think, and here we can read between the lines, and the church supports the position, he has to leave behind his habits, his ways of thinking, the perspective he has for making sense of the world. All right, we're standing in a beautiful Orthodox church, and so we can play with perspective a bit in a way that the church wants us to. When you're standing, like where I'm standing, okay, this front pew looks bigger than that back pew. Is that actually true? No, it's the perspective that I have. So the further you get from me, the smaller you get, right? So the person way back there, hi, you're smaller than the person up here. So you're less important to me. And if you were to take a walk, you'd get less and less. You'd reach a vanishing point, right? That's perspective. So what's the center of my world? Me, right? Everywhere I go, everything is more important, bigger when it gets closer, and less important when it goes away, right? Okay, now what do we do in the church? We reverse the perspective. Okay, you can see it very simply. See the icon of Christ? Is the back cover bigger than the front of the Bible that he's holding? Yes. Is that because the iconographer didn't know how to paint? He's flipping the perspective. See if I can take this mic with me. It's a big mic. I got it. Okay. I feel like Bob Barker. Do you remember Bob Barker? He had a mic like this, didn't he, Father? He did. All right, so see the back cover? It's bigger than the front page. It's a reverse perspective. So what is it telling you? As you get farther away from him, you vanish. He's the center, not you. Everything vanishes. So it's not as if, I know, literally, if I walk away from that icon, it gets smaller, but the icon is suggesting the reverse. We do that in all of our iconography. We reverse the perspective. Stick this back in here. So God, in inviting Abram to go on this journey, is asking Abram to reverse his way of thinking, to gain a new perspective. We have a really nice Greek word for that. What is it? Metanoia. To repent. What's this? A metanoia. That's a metanoia. I just bow down, okay? As I bow down, and as I stand up, I do something. What did I do? Make the sign of the cross. Is the cross a metanoia, a new way of thinking? Death becomes life, right? The whole journey of faith is based on flipping a switch and getting you to think in the reverse. How is Abram going to get to his destination? Who's going to show him the way? You need a fixed point. What's the fixed point? God. The fixed point is God, and it comes out in the verse in the following way. Get out of your country, from your kindred, from your father's house, to a land I will show you. who knows where Abram's going? God knows. Okay, do you remember the disciples are in a boat? It's the middle of the watch, and they are in the middle of the sea. Has anybody been in a boat in the middle of the sea in a storm? I have. I took a ferry from London to Dublin when I was about 22 years old, and it was a rough night at sea. And the ferry was pitching up and down, and I didn't have money. I was a student, so I didn't buy or purchase a berth. I was, you know, basically with the Dubliners who were drinking in the bar, and I was kind of just sitting there with my backpack. And you can't tell sky from sea when it's going crazy, right? And the boat's just pitching. You lose sense of direction. You know where you are. That's what's going on with the disciples. In the middle of the sea, in the middle of the night, there's a storm. Where's Jesus? Asleep. And what do they say to him? Get up. Do you not care that we are about to perish? And what does he say to them? Oh, you have little faith. Right? That little faith was also something that he lauded. Doesn't he say in another place, if you have faith as of a mustard seed? So that's not, have you ever seen a mustard seed? I do a thing with youth where I have them hold a mustard seed. I mean, they're like, they're little. So is little faith a problem? Not necessarily. But the faith they had was not uncompromising. They didn't have a steadfastness of faith. They didn't really believe that Jesus was who he said he was. How was he going to get them safely to shore? He didn't care they were perishing. What does Jesus do? He calms the storm, and they find themselves at shore. How does Abram make the journey? God will show him. God is the fixed point. Now let's see if this theory of mine holds true within the Bible. Let's go forward a bit to the story or journey in Exodus. Once again, there's a man, Moses, and he's instructed to go on a journey to guide a people this time. He's not going to go by himself, but he's going to take an entire nation through the wilderness. And they're going to go to a promised land. Without a map or a plan. Don't the Israelites say to Moses, was it so bad in Egypt that you had to take us out here so we could die in the desert without food or water? We'd been better off back there. Isn't that what we do? Once God tries to push us a little bit out of the nest, how about Moses' successor, Joshua? The same thing. He's told to cross the Jordan River and enter into Cana, and he's not told what he's going to do once he does. We can go back to the Garden of Eden and our foreparents, Adam and Eve, and they're given a choice. They are told to choose between something uncompromising and fixed and something unstable. And the question becomes, will they navigate their lives according to the fixed reference point provided by God or on their own? How does this choice come out? Well, don't be naive. Whether it's the garden, whether it's Abram, whether it's Joshua, whether it's Moses, whether it's the Sinai, whether it's a desert where sands are always shifting, whether it's an unknown promised land, again and again we are told that the reference point cannot be in ourselves. But what happens in Genesis? Who do they choose to follow? Adam and Eve. Who do they choose? The serpent. And they make a choice for themselves. Right? It looked pleasing to the eye, the text says, and they ate. So the reference point becomes themselves. Same as I was giving you in the perspective example. Who gets to choose? Unpack, if you will, the phrase, Father, come on. What is the person asking me to do as a priest? To follow their perspective, right? And what is it that my role is? Is it to follow your perspective? Is that what you want? Whose perspective am I supposed to follow? God's. But you'll criticize me for doing that. Why? Because it's not your perspective. What happens if you have your perspective instead of a fixed point? You get lost, right? Now, in Genesis 1:1, it says, "In the beginning, God made heaven and earth. The earth was invisible and unfinished." What does that mean? Before God started to do something, what did the earth look like? Unfinished and formless. What does that mean? Huh? Chaos. It was all shifting. You know, it's silly to me. I taught for a little while in an evangelical university, Colorado Christian University. I taught New Testament studies there. And so I would discuss the Bible with Christians of a different persuasion, and they had this notion of the Bible's inerrancy. Do you know what I'm talking about? The scripture is infallible, right? So if it says 7 days, it was 7 days. And I remember in my faculty interview, they asked me if I held to that position. I said, absolutely not. And they went, you want me to prove it? Right? I can prove to you that the Bible is not exactly correct about scientific facts. Okay? That's not its point, is it? You guys okay? Everybody okay? Theologically, spiritually, it is 100% correct. Without God, is man cast into a formless void? Yes. Okay? The point of the text is to infer to you, the reader, that when God comes into creation, he sets an order. What do we call Christ? Logos. What does the word mean? Word? What else? Reason. Cause. When we say Hagia Sophia, holy wisdom, what does Sophia refer to? Christ. That God sets a wisdom, a reason, a cause, a meaning to life that we have to begin to reference. So in the story of Genesis, if you think that the story is somehow describing to you in a scientific term how the universe was created, you're going to miss it. Rather, it's making an argument. The world is formless and without shape. And God comes in, and what's the first thing he does? He separates the water from the land. Have you ever tried to walk on water? I only know one other person that's done it successfully. Besides Jesus, Peter. Now, what does the text say? You guys, I'm telling you, what's so great about the Bible is while it's not an inerrant, infallible word of God, it is completely and totally accurate. When Peter got out of the boat, he went like this. And the water was firm. What was he looking at? Jesus. And what does the text say? He looked at the water and sank. If you have a fixed point, everything's firm and uncompromising, unstable. The text is accurate. It's telling you how do we make sense of everything? Well, with Christ in view, we can. Just like Peter could when he stepped out of the boat. By the way, we took that architectural tour on the river. It's fantastic. And you go underneath the, I know it as the Sears Tower. Willis Tower. And I guess way up at the top there, they have those new observation decks that are glass-bottomed. Do you know what I'm talking about? So she said that, you know, that the human mind is hardwired, that if you look down as you walk out, you will freeze. The body will not stand on something unfirm. But if you look up, you will. So, of course, my mind moves to the theological, and I think, oh, exactly. If we look up, then we can walk out into space and stand firm. But if we look at the ground, right, the Metanya, do we stay here? No. Now, I'm not a philologist, but I do know, I think I'm correct, that one of the meanings of anthropos is that being which can look up. Can an animal? What does an animal do? Walks around, right? On all fours. Can't look up. Human being can. What happened in the parable of the prodigal? Where was he eating? With the pigs. If you're going to eat with the pigs, what do you got to do? You got to get down, right? And what do pigs eat in? Slop. Have you ever stood in slop? Is it very firm? No, it's gushy and, you know, they defecate in it and they're eating out of it. It's like, it's just nasty, right? What does the text say? He came to himself and he arose. And then what? He set his eye towards his father's house and made the journey back home. And where was he at the time? In a faraway country. The Gospels themselves are a story of a journey with a fixed point. If you follow the Gospel of Mark in particular, it moves geographically from the hinterlands, the no man's land of Jesus' birth and ministry, to Jerusalem, and to a fixed point, the cross. And the catavasias of the cross, I don't know if you've ever heard them in English. They begin with, when Moses inscribed the cross with his right hand extended, he set the Red Sea to depart by placing a staff. Okay, have you ever held a staff? Is it firm? Right? Is water? Sticks the firm staff in the water, it splits, and then the text says, and the Israelites walked on dry land. What does the staff of Moses represent? The wood of the staff of Moses. The cross. And so the hymns of the cross say that the cross was firmly planted in the earth. And the cross becomes a fixed point for every coming generation of Christian. Remember earlier how I said the navigators made their way? They put the bottom of the stick on the horizon. They put the top of the stick in the sky. And then they could navigate. Base of the cross is in the horizon. The top of the cross is in the sky, in the heavens. Firmly planted with it in front of us, we can walk through a changing world with uncompromising faith. And so we recognize that the reality of our journey of uncompromising faith can only be accomplished in recognizing the absolute, the unyielding, steadfast, and firm position of God. We're going to close out our first talk, and if you have questions, I'm happy to take them. But let me point out that I began the talk by pointing out all that was compromising. And I said, now I've got to turn towards what is good and what is light. And again, because the scriptures are so accurate in their portrayal of the theological significance of our God and what he's done for us, let's look at it this way. I brought to you that the story of faith and uncompromising faith begins with the person of Abraham, right? Where does the genealogy of Christ begin in Matthew? Abraham. It's technical. Where does Luke begin his genealogy? Adam. But not Matthew. He starts with Abraham. What's the first Bible passage you read in the New Testament? Matthew, chapter 1, verse 1. How did Bibles used to be built? It was a scroll. So you had to unroll it. And you couldn't read chapter 5 till you read chapter 1. Right? What can you do now? You can flip. The church placed Matthew first because you needed to read Matthew first. Did you know that? Now, I went to graduate school, and the silly professor at this school that I had gone to said, well, we know that Mark is the older gospel. That's not the point. So in other words, he was saying Mark should have been first. No. The church put the Bible together. I'm going to get a bumper sticker made, and I'm going to make a lot of money. It's going to say, my church wrote your Bible. Matthew 1:1, it starts with Abraham, who's given a fixed point, God. Okay? Now, in Matthew's gospel, it's the same gospel that has the passage of the young lawyer who comes to Jesus and says, good teacher, what good thing shall I do that I may have eternal life? So he said to him, that's Jesus, why do you call me good? No one is good but one, that is God. Did the young lawyer believe that Jesus was good and God? He didn't. He was being sarcastic when he said, good teacher, what good thing? You know? And Jesus corrected him. The reference point is me. Where does the Gospel of John begin? Well, it connects us with the light. In Christ was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot comprehend it. You know, this reality of a fixed reference point is something that we often lose. And yet, how did the Magi find the Christ child in his home? A star, a fixed light in the heavens, guided them to the place where he lay with his mother. So in order for us to make our way to keep the fixed point of Jesus Christ as a means by which and the person through which we navigate life, we have to realize, if you will, that something is needed besides ourselves to have uncompromising faith. And we mentioned it earlier that the word repent is this word that causes us to change our way of thinking, our perspective. But it's the first public words of Jesus. But how are they rendered in Greek? Does anybody recall the exact word in Greek? Metanoite. Epsilon taf epsilon. Does that matter? It's a verb. Well, it's an imperative continuous. What's imperative continuous? It's a command. And the command is eternal. So like, you know, when you say to your kid, don't you ever? You know, that's an imperative continuous. As opposed to stop. Right? So Jesus says, metanoite. Repent and keep repenting. It's a constant process. If that constant process isn't there, if we don't always have, I always laugh at this, you say to somebody, what's to repent? They say, it's to make a 360. No, it's not. It's to make a 180. To repent is to make a 180, to change the direction, to renew our mind, our way of living, our way of thinking. And this is my new favorite phrase, it's to do a vujade. A vujade is to see what we have seen before, but this time to have the feeling that we're seeing it for the first time. Right? That's a vujade, as opposed to a deja vu. So we need to have vujade. It means we have to reject what we see as false. These are not fixed points. What is happening to marriage? What is happening in euthanasia? What we are legalizing in gambling and pot use? These are not fixed points. And we have to reject them. You know what mariners did the minute they found out that a map was false? It was a law. You had to burn the map. It was a capital offense if you put out a map that was inaccurate. Why? What happens if there's a shoal and the map you have doesn't show it? What happens to the mariner? They die. So a false map had to be burned. We have to burn these false maps, these false fixed points. And we need to begin to set a course that's fixed again. Now, in the second part of my talk, I'm going to get specific about how we do that, right? The means by which we can walk and stand in faith in Jesus Christ. Why did Christ get on the cross? Agape. Love. Why does a mother rush in when her child is sick? And the dad stands at the corner. Hey, she's throwing up. You may... some towels and a bucket here. And the mom's at the bedside. That self-sacrificing love, right? Okay, the definition of integrity is to know what's right from what is wrong, and to do what is right regardless of the risk to yourself, and to teach others to do the same. That's what integrity is. Where does it get its strength? Love. Christ, if we read the Gospel of John, he got on the cross because of love, not because he had to, but he loved us so much. It says, no greater love does a man have for his brother than to lay down his life. He had that love. So love gives us an amazing ability, and our love is broken, right? Remember, what does Jesus ask Peter? Do you love me? But he says the word agape in there. He says, you know, do you love me unconditionally, Peter? And what does Peter say? I like you. That had to hurt. So Jesus asks him a second time, Peter, do you love me unconditionally? And Peter says, yeah, I like you. And then so the third time he says, Peter, you like me. And that's when the text says, Peter was sorrowful for the third time. Jesus asked, do you like me? And he says, yes, Lord, ne kyrie, you know everything. I like you. Then what does Jesus say to him? Okay, Peter, that's fine. You just like me. When you were a child, you went where you wanted to, right? You walked where you would. But when you were older, you shall be bound and led to signify by what death he would die and glorify Christ. Well, Peter comes to a point of loving the Lord so much that he'll sacrifice himself. So what gets us over the hump? That love that is self-sacrificial. And that's what we're working on, right? And sometimes we get there and sometimes we don't. So in as much as we love, right, I would say that my whole marriage has been an exploration of self-sacrificial love. When I got married, I wooed her. You know, I wanted her to marry me. Then we got married and it was all about me. And I was a jerk. And, you know, I love her as much as she was serving me. And that doesn't work in marriage, does it? Try it. Okay, any other questions? Great question, Alex. Thank you. Yes, over here. Wait 1 second. He's going to bring the mic to you. Thank you, sir. George.
So he said in politics we hear the idea that we can't get anything done unless we compromise. Well, yeah. You know, and that's the whole point I'm making, is that in the world, you know, what does compromise mean? It means that you and I come to a mutually agreed upon solution. Okay? But the problem with compromise is that there's no fixed point. The fixed point is whatever you and I determine.
And that is how we end up in a shipwreck. In faith, as Father Andrew's title so rightly suggested, you cannot have a compromised faith. If you do, then you will not arrive safely in your destination. And I think for many of our parishes today, you know, the secular, you know, I don't really believe that we compartmentalize faith. You know, a lot of people talk about that now. They say, well, you know, you keep your faith in this box, you keep your work in this box. It's not a human being's work. Rather, it's all mashed together. But what I do think happens and is happening is that secularism has done what communism couldn't, right? It's done what the Ottomans couldn't do. Secularism has become the religion, right? And because it's become the religion, we've compromised all of our... I mean, in other words, how is it that a priest can literally be criticized for saying, you're living together, I love you, but we need to talk, you can't receive the Eucharist right now? No, Father, what you did is mean-spirited. That's a middle core value, isn't it? Let's all get along, right? What does St. Paul say? You want to know why some of you are sick? You want to know why some of you are dying? Because you have received the Eucharist in an unworthy manner. So, okay, I'm holding the medicine of immortality, and I just willy-nilly give it to you. Do you know what the Americans did when they got to the concentration camps, right? They saw those starving Jews, and they opened the gates and started feeding them. And what did the MDs do? Close the gates. Said, you can't feed these guys the food. It'll make them sick. We have to put them on a specialized diet. It's same with us when we're soul sick. The church is saying, we can't compromise here. In other words, for me to get you well, we've got to do the following thing. So when you say in politics, yeah, you're right. But the problem is that we've applied that same principle in the church and with matters of faith, and that's where we've erred. So the whole premise of my talk is you've got to abandon that sort of map. You've got to burn it up. And you've got to say, when I approach life and faith, I have to have this fixed point. And if I don't, I'm in trouble. You know, priests, we do it, right? We get lost. We compromise things. Yeah, I should probably let there be a belly dancer. That would probably help attendance. Well, a compromised position, isn't it? Right? Okay. I forgive me. I don't know if there's a belly dancer at this festival.
Not yet.
Any other questions? We are feeding you after this, so don't worry. I think there's food.
Why were they observing the Jewish law of prayer in the third hour in the temple if
they had met Christ?
That's it.
Yeah. So the question is,
why were they observing the Jewish hours of prayer if they had been disciples of Christ? You know, the church doesn't have this sort of notion of a complete and total break from its Jewish roots, right? We call ourselves the new Israel, don't we? We use the symbols of Israel, fig tree, grapes, wheat. We based our rhythm of prayer, when was the Jewish day, when did it begin? At evening. When do we begin the day? At evening. So we saw ourselves as the new Israel, and we know that historically, the disciples, after meeting Christ, would celebrate on Saturday, on the Sabbath, they would go to the temple, and then on Sunday they would commune together in the Eucharistic meal, right? And the church still keeps that. What do we call Saturday in the church? Sabbath. We still have it, right? What texts do we read from in the scriptures on Saturday? We don't read from the New Testament. We read from the Old Testament on Saturday at Vespers, right? You never hear a Vesper reading being the New Testament. So if you will, the disciples were keeping, if you will, that rhythm. And they had, of course, Christ. And they had the fullness of grace and truth in him, as the text of the Bible says. But they didn't, just break completely. All of those things, I mean, think about it. All of the Old Testament is nonsensical if it's not viewed through the lens of Christ. But at the same time, if the New Testament does not have the Old Testament, it too is nonsensical. You don't understand its figurative meanings, its theology, its perspective. And so the one complements the other. We don't place the one over the other, but we certainly see the one as preparatory. So all that, you know, Peter and the disciples grew up in that was right and good. I mean, I'll give you another example, one last one, that should sort of wrap out the point. Does Christ abandon the commandments? No, but he expands them. He says, you heard it said that thou shalt not commit adultery. So dudes were like, great, no problem, I got it. As long as I don't sleep with another woman, I'm fine. Fixed point. Just avoid that. What did Jesus say? But I say to you, a man who looks at another woman has committed adultery. Now every guy's going, oh man, how do I walk into the marketplace? And so, if you will, Christ doesn't abandon, he simply fulfills, expands, and makes whole the Old Testament. And so the hours of prayer are the same thing. The church took them, which were prophetic, which were anticipatory and preparatory, and she fulfills them in the church. And that's why the disciples continued in that. And why we in the church still do, right? With all of our rhythms. Any other questions? Is Father Andrew still in the church? Oh, he went out. Okay. Oh, there he is. Father Andrew.
Multitasking. Is there a question on the
phone? No, I think we're ready for lunch.
Okay, what we're going to do is maybe you can cover this in the next session, but having heard you, you spoke so beautifully, and we thank you very much for your very well prepared topic, and you covered so many different areas. If everyone's at a different point, mm-hmm. everyone in our secular society, mm-hmm. how does the church lead these people to that point? Mm-hmm. If everyone's on different navigation systems,
yeah.
Just a thought.
No, it's just
as priests, we deal with people mm-hmm. all different walks of life. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
and they're all up in the end, but they're all our children,
right?
Children of God,
right?
The church.
Yeah, I think what you're asking is fantastic. I mean, I know as a child growing up at the cathedral in Denver, they had a Tonelli mosaic in the back of the apse. And when we were kids, we used to say, watch this. If you walk around the church, the bunny has eyes move with you. And it was true. You know, the way that Tonelli had done it artistically, whether you stood in the back, whether you came to the front or in the middle, it was like the Paniya was looking at you. You know, we were like, as kids, we didn't understand that. We were like, whoa, right? So your point, you know, that the church, no matter where someone is, whether it's in the back, in the front, in the middle, in the side, the same loving embrace comes to them, right? So I think the perspective is that the church stays put. And yet, at the same time, the church doesn't refuse to reach out, you know? I know with Father Andrew and his pastoral work, it doesn't matter where someone's at, right? You're going to go. You're going to go. But the idea then is that you're going to bring them in. That's the goal. That's the goal. And I think for us as Orthodox Christians, you know, when we view the same reality of people being at different places, whether it be ourselves or a family member or a friend, I think the idea is, where do we lead them? You see what I mean? What did Eve do? She said, the serpent told me to do this, and I think you should try it too. So where was she leading him? Into her own sin. What do we do as friends? Watch this crazy video. And they shouldn't be watching it, right? Or people tell me dirty jokes. They tell you dirty jokes? They come up and say, Father, there's a dirty joke, but it's funny. And I go, don't tell me the joke. Or, Father, have you seen The Sopranos? And I know I'm dating myself. I don't even think, is The Sopranos on? Yeah, you're like, no, don't say you we watch The Sopranos. But I say, well, I didn't. So where do we lead people, right? And even in, as far away as we might be, maybe we can lead them a step in, you know? And one last thought on that. There's only one homily in the church that we read that's fixed in the liturgical text. It's the homily of St. John Chrysostom that we read at the Paschal Vigil. And as a kid, we loved it. Epicanthe! Right? It is vexed. It is embittered, or whatever, you know? Now, if you look at his text and you consider carefully what that great saint of the church is saying, he basically says that God honors the attempt as much as he honors the accomplishment. So if we, no matter how far away we are, make an attempt, God says, we'll call it good. It's like playing, as I like to say, goldfish with my yaya. I would say, yaya, do you have fours? And she'd say, no, you should ask me if I have threes. So then I'd say, yaya, do you have a three? I have a three! And then I'd be like, she had a three! You know, I was 6 years old. I thought, this is magical, incredible, I'm winning! And you know, yaya's handing over her cards. And God's like that, you know, he says, okay, Father, it doesn't matter where they are. If they just make an attempt, I'm going to call it good. So no matter where we are, in our distance from God or our perspective, the church stays firm, but God says, just take at least one step, maybe even turn towards me. But yeah, we can talk about some more.